At the end of the 9th century, a chronicler wrote of a time before his day when a mighty king in Mercia struck terror throughout Britain. This king, he said, built a huge dike between the Welsh and the English, stretching from sea to sea. The king's name was Offa. Offa's Dyke is the biggest and most remarkable archaeological monument in Britain. It's difficult to appreciate the scale of it until you're actually on it, but it is the sheer size that hits you first. If you went to Flanders, you'd expect to find First World War trenches still preserved, overgrown, no longer sharp-edged. But this, look at it, it's 1,200 years old, and it's still in places 20 foot from the bottom of the ditch to the top of the walk, 60 foot wide, and it runs on a frontier of 150 miles. The leading motorway contractors threw up their hands in dismay when we asked them to cost it now. Impossible, they said, and a recent historian has compared the labour involved to the building of the Great Pyramid. The dike invites questions. What was it for? How was it built? Who was the king who, in the so-called Dark Ages, had the power and vision to execute it? Offa has had no biographer in the 20th century, and as far as we know, he had none in the 8th either. But despite the destruction of most of the written evidence from his time, archaeologists are now turning up new clues in the search for the founder of the First Kingdom of England. How do we find out the truth about an event which happened 1,200 years ago? Well, in strict terms, it's impossible. The comparative objectivity which the modern journalist is afforded by photographs, film, videotape, Hansard, even newspapers, is a far cry from the inferential work of the medieval historian. There, sometimes, even the simple framework of events is lacking. This is Corpus Christi College, Cambridge. It's one of the world's greatest collections of Anglo-Saxon manuscripts. And this is the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, one of the treasures of the English nation. It was written in the circle of Alfred the Great about 100 years after Offa's death, and it's a small miracle that it survived the succeeding 1,100 years. You might say it was the equivalent of the newspapers of the time, a series of annals jotted down originally in Easter tables and later circulated in booklets around the royal monasteries. And it contains pretty much what you'd expect, a big frieze, an epidemic, wars, but chiefly the deeds of kings, because like most official products of the Middle Ages, it's royal propaganda. And here, in a few laconic references, is the core of our historical testimony on Offa. The year is 757, and the language is English. Sailchen year Offa feng to reacher. He became king. And 39 years later, his death. Pope Adrian and Offa kuning forth ferdon. In between, as you can see, the West Saxon annalists didn't have very much to write. There are big gaps. There are just a couple of ambiguous references to the battles in which Offa achieved his supremacy over the southern English, the execution of an opponent, and references to the big church synods in which Offa dominated the ideology of his time. Not much to go on. You can see what the problem is. Imagine, for the sake of argument, the 31st century trying to draw a picture of us on the basis, say, of a couple of mutilated white papers, an EEC trade communique, a book of cuttings from the Times, and the ruins of the M1. We of the here and now always tend to underestimate the complexity and richness of so-called primitive societies. The Angles were warlike barbarians when they first came to Britain.
The tradition in Offa's family was that they had emigrated from Angeln in Schleswig on the German-Danish border, where their ancestors had been kings. Offa's kinsmen may have settled in East Anglia in the early 6th century, and within a generation, it seems they were driven by overpopulation into the Midlands. There they became known as Mercians, not one nation, but 30 tribes. The Penkasaten, the Huiche, the Noxgaga. At first pagan, the immigrants were converted to Christianity in the middle of the 7th century. In two more generations, they had become the superpower of Britain, their king Offa lording it over them with newfangled titles like King of the Whole Fatherland of the English, a rival in prestige to his continental contemporary Charlemagne. The center of this Mercian empire was the territory of the Tomsaten, with its churches at Lichfield and Repton and its royal seat at Tamworth. Our journey is such as Offa himself might have taken on his annual progress between the Midlands, the Welsh border, and the south. And the search for Offa begins here at Repton in Derbyshire.
Apart from the cooling towers and the power lines, this landscape hasn't changed much in 1,000 years. There wouldn't have been a spire on the church in Anglo-Saxon times, and of course the school wasn't there, but essentially Repton is what it's always been, a cluster of buildings around the site of the Royal Monastery on this natural escarpment above the flood levels of the River Trent.
According to the Chronicle, Offa's predecessor, Athelbald, was buried here in 757. Athelbald, an old man, was murdered by his bodyguard nearby at Seckington, at whose instigation we don't know. But Offa, a young member of the royal family, expelled Athelbald's heir and seized the throne. The dig here has opened up a cemetery of Mercian nobles around the church, the kind of men who formed Offa's entourage. And in a remarkable piece of architectural detective work, the actual mausoleum of Athelbald has now been identified. It's still standing to roof height, the level of the present windowsills, and is now surrounded by the later church. Set on this massive plinth, it was originally a freestanding mausoleum in the classical style, probably topped by a wooden pyramidal roof. The burial chamber, which is now the crypt, was modified within a century of Athelbald's death, with the addition of twisted columns imitating those in the Vatican, and the original church was extended over it. Here, the later King Wiglaf was buried. But who had remodeled the mausoleum and why? Dr. Harold Taylor has made a lifetime study of Anglo-Saxon churches.
But now we are in the earliest part of the building that we think is an 8th century Anglo-Saxon burial place or mausoleum.
Where would the body have been buried? What was the custom? Would it be inside of the crypt or in the middle?
Yes, well, you can see at once that I couldn't lie down in this recess, nor could you put a king's coffin in this recess. But the burial practice in abbeys in the 8th and 9th century was, and indeed earlier than that, was to bury outside and after 20 years or so to take up the body after the flesh had rotted away. You reverently washed the bones, you possibly even dismembered the skeleton. You put the skeleton in a relatively small box or shrine, and here the box or shrine of the king would have lain in this flat-topped rectangular recess in the side of the mausoleum. And you can see we have one, two, and indeed three and four recesses of this sort. Now, I think that this is the mausoleum of King Wiglaf in which St. Wistern was buried. And I think it is highly likely that the addition of these ornamental pilasters, these twisted columns, and this vaulted roof, that these are all the work either of King Wiglaf as his mausoleum, or even possibly the work of his predecessor but one, the great King Offa himself.
It is possible, then, that Offa both built this mausoleum and, late in his life, remodeled it. But the key to it, his role in Athelbald's murder, remains a mystery. On the other side of Offa's kingdom, 6 miles from the dyke, is the Iron Age hill fort of Sutton Walls, scene of another royal murder. The chronicle tells us merely that Offa executed Athelbert, king of the East Angles, who later became a saint. 12th century romances, laced with a rigmarole of passion and intrigue, place that event here. These legends say Offa had a palace here. What is there now?
Well, as you can see, the northern ramparts of Sutton Walls are still pretty impressive. You can see for miles from the top, so it's an ideal place for a security-minded king like Offa to hold his court, surrounded by his vigilant bodyguard. And if the tradition is right, then the archaeologists could expect to find up here the wooden foundations and post holes of a wooden hall and the ancillary buildings that we normally get associated with a Dark Age palace complex, maybe a little chapel, perhaps even an outside loo, a fenced compound for the hunting dogs, and so on. But if there was an Offan palace up on the hill here, we're not going to find it now. A waste disposal firm has been allowed to sink pools for liquid waste and to dump rubbish on the top. It's been called the worst example of archaeological conservation in Britain. It may be that, but for now, wherever Offa's palace at Sutton was, this most potent part of the Offa myth must remain just that, myth. But 4 miles down the road, the myth has been swallowed hook, line and sinker. In Hereford, you can stroll down Offa Street and sip mead in the Offa Bar. The cathedral itself stands as the symbol of the power of St. Ethelbert's cult, a cult which brought tourists and sold guidebooks as early as the 10th century. And as late as the Victorian era, the building was adorned with sentimental versions of the murder. The saint himself, incidentally, is perhaps more likely to have been buried at the site of the 8th century church of St. Guthlac under Castle Green. When Ron Shoesmith began digging here 10 years ago, he felt sure he'd find Offa's track. Strategically placed on Offa's southwest frontier, was this the site of a royal fort? Was it even an 8th century border trading post? No traces of permanent town life have yet been found in Offa's Mercia. Do they exist at all? Hereford was the obvious place to look. Round the back of the greengrocer's and through a makeshift car park, Ron took me to his most significant find. Archaeology is not all glamour, and this is a far cry from shirt sleeves in Luxor.
Because we dug a trench which was about 6 yards long and about a yard wide, and within it we found the whole of the Saxon defences.
And this is the exposed section of it?
This is really what we found. Probably the best surviving stretch of Saxon defensive masonry that's been so far exposed in the whole of the British Isles.
The sequence here suggests that this stone face is a Viking-era rebuild of an earlier turf rampart.
Is this an important site?
Yes, this is. Well,
but of Offa's royal fort, there's no sign. Ron's view of Hereford is now not military at all.
Well, I see Hereford as a religious settlement which was occasionally used by Offa when he was coming round with really what must have been his warrior band. And he stayed here for a few nights and he collected his taxes.
And that's all?
And that's all, really. Yes, it was a camping settlement.
So if we wanted to imagine a fortification, you can't provide us with one?
I don't think so. It is possible that part of the town was defended, but until we can really do large-scale excavations, then we really can't say.
So the evidence to support urban life in the West Midlands is not here. Great dyke builder as Offa was, he was not a town planner. And if we want a clue to his commerce and contacts, we must leave Hereford and follow his court on its summer journey through the royal farms and estates to the big city. The city of London is the thriving market for many nations who come by land and sea. So said the Anglo-Saxon historian Bede, writing in Jarrow in 731. But despite that, and despite the clear evidence of lucrative port taxes in the charters, the archaeological evidence for Offa's London is so far minimal. Now, a little imagination is going to be needed here. I'm standing, if you can believe it, in the middle of the site of the Roman fort at Cripplegate. 100 yards that way, you can still see the Roman walls, very well preserved in some parts, although mainly covered by medieval ones. But in Offa's day, they would have made a safe haven, a 200-yard square with walls 20 foot high. And Wood Street, down here in front of me, marks the line of the road down the middle of the Roman fort. The church in the middle is the Church of St. Alban, built by Christopher Wren, which was destroyed in the Blitz. And 13th century St. Alban's tradition has it that Offa founded that church to serve as the royal chapel adjacent to the palace here within the fort. When these ruins were excavated, an 8th century, probably church building, was indeed discovered, although it's now lost to us. So it does seem that when Offa came down to London on his periodic forays to keep the south in check, he resided here within the military buildings of the Roman fort, and it was here in the chapel of St. Alban that our puritanical hard man went down on his knees to beg forgiveness for his sins. Imagination is all very well, of course, but that is just imagination, as is the 13th century portrait of the king. The reality of 8th century London is here next to St. Paul's at the GPO site in Newgate, which is being dug now. Here, they have found only an enigmatic layer of black earth, over 4 feet deep, containing 700 years of our history, from the later Roman Empire almost to the Norman Conquest, with Offa in the middle, and as yet there is no means of analysing it. It may represent occupation, it may be levelling for cultivation within sight of the cathedral, but that is just a guess, and this meagre evidence is rare enough. 80% of properties within the city have basements which have partially destroyed the Anglo-Saxon levels. Better prospects lie on the waterfront. When Billingsgate is dug next year, it's hoped that the waterlogged timbers of Offa's wharves may turn up. But until then, with London, a key site in Western Europe, we draw another blank. Three small sites in the Eastern Midlands were summer residences of the Mercian kings on their journeys to and from London. When Offa stayed at Earthlingborough with his subject kings and nobles, did they all sleep in tents, or was there a royal hall? Gumley, on its wooded knoll fronting the Welland Valley, was surrounded by forests which were ideal for the royal occupations of hunting and hawking, and doubtless Offa took his sport when he stayed in this once famous place. The flat, ditched plaza behind Gumley Church is the site of the medieval village, and perhaps also of the Mercian royal hall, but only excavation will tell, and as yet, Gumley has not even been mapped on the ground. Brixworth in Northamptonshire. This church has been called the finest of its period north of the Alps. Was this where Offa held the great church synods mentioned in the chronicle? Tradition places a royal palace here too, and it seems that the church was extensively rebuilt in Offa's day, with this outside ring crypt, then roofed, which allowed the passage of pilgrims through to a central shrine, connected to the main church by inner doors which can still be seen. The shrine perhaps contained a relic of Saint Boniface, who died in 754. And a piece of human bone found in the last century blocked up in a wall in this stone reliquary may be that very relic. Brixworth abounds in fascinating questions, but surely only a king could have patronized the building of such a large church at this time. Was that king Offa? And was it here that he had his son consecrated king on his own 30th jubilee? The part of the church where these events can be imagined most vividly is now hidden where the casual visitor might miss it. This west wall inside the church shows the traces of several windows of a once elaborate westwork. Through the doors at the bottom of the tower, an inner chamber is revealed. On the far wall, the great bricked-up arch is the original west door through which the king would have entered the church. This west chamber is the one survivor of a set of five, originally all of two stories. To get up to the second floor today, you must climb the stairs. These steps were added in Anglo-Saxon times when the tower was built. Although later than Offa, they are still 1,000 years old. On the second floor is the king's own room, now used by the Brixworth bell ringers, an 8th century royal chapel above the former west door. Here windows looked out as well as into the church, and here we can picture Offa and his son showing themselves to their people. Offa was now about 50, as old as anyone could expect to live at that time. And none knew better than he how unstable political power was. But at the moment of his son's consecration, he surely allowed himself feelings of pride and relief. The descent which extended from Angeln in Schleswig was assured.
When they grow older, dictators usually get more religious, especially in societies where every act on earth is felt to be mirrored in heaven. And in the Dark Ages, kings like Offa never tired of pressing home the analogy. They gave alms to the poor and rich gifts to God and his saints. They went on pilgrimage for the good of their souls, and they founded churches and even kept vigil inside holy shrines, which you can still see peasants doing in some parts of Europe today. But of all the treasures that Offa gave to the churches in England, no trace survives, except perhaps here in Worcester Cathedral.
Back in Corpus Christi College in Cambridge, a note in a later medieval manuscript says that King Offa gave a beautiful Bible to the church at Worcester. And here in the cathedral library, there are three fragments of a once beautiful Anglo-Saxon Bible. It's sheer chance that they survive today. The book that they were in was destroyed a very long time ago, because it was in the early 1100s that these pieces were stuck into the binding of a book of sermons here at Worcester. In that way, many of the great books of Anglo-Saxon England were cast to the four winds. But here they are. Now, this wasn't any old book. It was a large-scale deluxe commission written in this fine, majuscule handwriting, probably done in Canterbury or perhaps even in Mercia itself, but during Offa's reign. So there seems a good case for thinking that this may be a fragment of the Bible which Offa laid on the high altar here at Worcester and is therefore
the one surviving artifact we can associate with him personally. There is no reason to think Offa was literate. Few Dark Age kings were. But he understood the symbolic and the practical value of the book. As the English scholar Alcuin wrote to him, "I am delighted you're so keen on encouraging reading, so that the light of wisdom, now extinct in so many places, may shine in your kingdom. You are the glory of Britain, the trumpet of the gospel, our sword and shield against the enemy." As winter came on, Offa's itinerary took him back to the Mercian heartland and to his chief residence at Tamworth. We now know that the citadel of the Tom Satan was a squared enclosure on the River Tame, centered on the church, and surrounded by a defensive ditch of Offa's period. To imagine it then, you need to think away the Norman castle on its mound and a lot else besides. But under this modern development, Professor Philip Rotz made the most sensational Offan find yet, the intact timbers of a two-story 8th century watermill.
Well, the most remarkable feature, of course, is the preservation. The whole of the substructure of the mill was there, preserved in timber. No, it was still quite hard. It very quickly shrank, of course, when it was exposed to the air, but it was enough to see all the timber joints. One of the most remarkable examples of Saxon woodwork and actually still preserved. This is one of the paddles, and there were 14 of these, and so it'd be going around like this, and the water would be striking on that place there, so as this went round, it'd be striking each paddle in turn as it goes round, and you notice how carefully this is curved, so the water striking this gives the maximum impact.
The water wheel turned these millstones, some of which were not of local grit, but expensive imports.
This is one of the most exciting things, that this stone comes from the Rhineland. It's an import from the Carolingian Empire, and the reason why they imported these is because they're very light. Very good evidence of imports, of course, from Charlemagne's country into this part of Mercia.
This could actually be one of the stones that Charlemagne sent to
Offa. It could indeed, yes. Yeah.
The mill then looks like a royal mill, specifically serving Offa's court. Here they would have made the flour for the great feast on Boxing Day 781, when a charter records Offa in Tamworth entertaining his wife and family and the elders of the Tom Satan. Historians have always taken such gatherings to mean that Offa had a palace here, and they're probably right, although the evidence is not contemporary. But where was the palace? Bob Meeson has recently been looking for traces of a great building in the open space by the church. He's sure he's on the right track, but he can't excavate. It's the graveyard. He presents his evidence here for the first time.
The palace, I believe, may have stood on a substantial rectangular earth platform within the confines of the larger area of the town. The evidence upon which we base this supposition is first from property boundaries, which we can show to be of early date, join up to the edge of this early platform. A detailed contour survey of the centre of the town makes it very clear that we have an elevated site, and the top of that site is partly occupied by the church here. The church, however, does not stand right on the crest of the summit of the spur. It seems to have shared the site with another building, and I ask the question, was that other building the palace which Offa constructed in Tamworth?
A later writer called it the wonder and marvel of the age, perhaps because of its interior decorations. Our reconstruction is the first time all the evidence has been drawn together for a picture of Offa's royal centre.
For the palace itself, as yet we can only guess, but the Beowulf poet may well have seen it. Lofty and wide-gabled, strongly braced inside and out, its high roof gilded, its mead benches decked in gold. But it's the dyke itself which has yielded most secrets in the search for Offa. When the Cambridge historian Cyril Fox surveyed it 50 years ago, he concluded it was an agreed boundary between peoples with wide gaps to allow passage on the tradeways from Wales. But was this really conceivable in view of the Welsh Chronicle's record of continuous warfare with Offa? After Fox finished his field work in 1934, no more work was carried out on the dyke. But in the last 5 years, Dr. David Hill and the Extramural Department of Manchester University have conducted a series of small digs wherever development or erosion have threatened. And Hill has been able to test Fox's theory about its purpose and to show for the first time details of the dike's construction.
The people who dug the bank and the ditch in one place were not the same people who dug the next piece. In other words, there is not one great gang working from A to B. Mm-hmm. Secondly, it seems to argue for regional groups coming. An organisation whereby you could pull people from all over the country to work on a great project. And there is later evidence for this sort of thing happening. And one of the things that will happen on the dike, I'm quite certain, is that in time you'll be able to recognise these areas of gangwork. Of course, what you always hope to do is find the coin in the bottom of the trench, the piece of pottery. But A, it's A ceramic, there is no pottery here. And secondly, they don't seem to have dropped anything. We have done 50-odd holes and we never found a blessed thing.
Well. Have your digs enabled you to be any clearer about the function of the dyke? It sounds an obvious question, but what was it for?
In the ground, the things that we have found must show that it was a considerable barrier. If it was painted white, I'd firmly believe it was an agreed boundary. If it was painted black and white, I'd believe it even more. And if it said, you know, Welsh beware all the way along every 15 feet, it would be even better. But it doesn't. It actually looks like a fortification. Fox found 12 original gateways. And these gateways, according to him, were passageways through the dike. Mm-hmm. Well, they simply consist, as this one here did, of a gap. Now, it's difficult to see, there would have been a lot of damage, but the dike comes here, and then in this gap, there was the Kerry Hill Ridgeway, a very, very important way out of Wales. And you can see it passing out over along that grass and then picking up on the turnpiking at the top. Now, if anywhere was going to be a simple gateway, this is it. It's got to be here. Therefore, there has to be a causeway, and here's a causeway here. You dig down into the causeway, and the causeway disappears, and you have the original ditch underneath. In other words, this is later than the dike. Now the question arises, all right, the route is blocked. How did people get in and out? Even if it's only soldiers going out to chase Welshmen away, where are the sally gates? Where do they get out? One day, and perhaps not long ahead, people will be doing large-scale excavations to clear these points up. And then they're going to find, I think they're going to find, defences behind the dike.
Hill now sees the dike as a sharply scarped bank 25 feet from the top of the mound to the bottom of the ditch. That's 4 feet higher than the present surface here, surmounted by a wooden palisade. In some places, there was a stone breastwork whose remains have been found in the ditch. It's not certain there were towers, but it is possible, and we've included one in this reconstruction. There's no need for Offa to have seen Hadrian's Wall. The one book we know he possessed, Bede's History, describes how the Romans built just such a work, and providing an effective garrison would be no problem at all for a king of Offa's resources.
Now, if a garrison sends out four men to walk along here, say the mile and a half to the top, it means that every half hour or so, a small group of people go by. Now, the Welsh, imagine your 40 Welshmen on their ponies hiding down in yonder valley. They see them go by. They come pounding across here, and then they have to get up over. Now, to get their horses up over, they've got to break down through the palisade. Whilst they're doing that, of course, back come the patrol. They have a skirmish on the front here. Up come the two garrisons. And then, you see, the garrison, one of the first things they do when they realise they've got trouble on their hands, they light their beacon fire, perhaps, on the top of the hill. Now, from that hill there, for example, you can see, 19 miles to Llanymynech. Between here and Llanymynech, all the garrisons would be picking up their stuff and they'd be moving this way sharply. A beacon lit there would bring all of the people, not necessarily garrison, see, but farmers,
yeomen living in their villages. They also would get their pony, and they'd pound off as well. A matter of hours, you could have 300, 400, 500, 600 people converging on just this spot. If you want to see Offa, you can either stand in the British Museum coin room and hold a handful of coins and to look at those coins, a tremendous artistic and administrative achievement. You can see them there, or you can see this. And Offa is here. This is the frontier of his kingdom, and he's having no nonsense. He is an imperial figure, and this certainly is the work of an imperial figure.
For the so-called barbarians of the 7th and 8th centuries, the Roman Empire cast the same sort of afterglow that the British Empire did in post-colonial Africa, and their kings were as susceptible to its style as Armin to the Sandhurst tradition or Bokassa to Napoleonic ceremonial. Vigorous and violent, naive yet cunning, they legitimized their rule with the trappings of empire. These men were setting themselves up as the civilized heirs of Rome, and prodded by the missionary zeal of the Catholic Church, they learned fast. By the time we get to Offa, a man of greater power and sophistication than his predecessors, the Roman legacy has generated a new style. The unique freestanding mausoleum at Repton, its burial chamber with the twisted columns, the lost palace and its stone church within the Roman fort in London, the wonder and marvel of the age at Tamworth, the Dyke with its palisade, ditches and wall walks, and this beautiful coin representing Offa as a new Valentinian, a new Theodosius. Offa began his reign as an illiterate barbarian. Not long before his death, 4 decades later, the grizzled old dictator was an honored visitor at the papal court in Rome, a figure of European stature. The irony is that for all the ruthlessness with which he secured his kingdom, his only son died childless a year after him, and the dynasty collapsed. What Offa left his successors was a monument and a concept, a kingdom of all the English. There is one last piece in this imperfect jigsaw puzzle which we can fit. Where was Offa buried? Well, Repton, Ruthven, and Rome have all been suggested, but the search for Offa ends here in the market town of Bedford on the eastern fringe of Offa's kingdom, because it was here that the monks of St. Albans remembered their benefactor having been buried. He's out there underneath the River Great Ouse, the chapel which covered his tomb long since swept away by the river. Here then the cortege came to rest, and here perhaps, as was the old tradition, the mounted warriors rode around the coffin, singing of his heroic deeds, praising his manhood and weeping for him. Fortham Offa was gifum ont guthum, ga kena man wida jewe othod. Wisdom hailed Ethel Sine. Offa was a great warrior who ruled his kingdom wisely and was famous for his victories and his generosity.